Thank you. Thank you, Jess White, for that generous introduction. As he said, I have known Jesse Lamar White for 4.5 decades, and so I know just how generous that introduction was. Some of the things he didn't tell you, he was my teacher. He has been my colleague. Most importantly, he's been my friend. 25 years ago, Jess White and I and 6 friends from Ole Miss, who graduated between the years of 1965 and 1970, began getting together for a long weekend somewhere in the United States. This group of 8 people have all taken very diverse paths in our professional and our personal lives. And most of the time, this get-together is the only time we see each other during the year. And I think it's fair to say that we've all been relatively successful in our chosen fields. But I think one of the biggest successes that we share, and one of the most meaningful, given the shifting uncertainties of time and geography and life, has been the ability to maintain a friendship over nearly half a century. So thank you, Jesse. Thank you for the introduction, but thank you for putting in the time and the effort to maintain the all too rare commodity of friendship. There you go. Before y'all get too carried away, the other reason Jess didn't tell most of those stories is he knows that I have both the Marines and the SEALs working for me. The Deal S. Wright Lecture that I am privileged to give is more than just a tribute to the legendary professor, public administration advocate that we just heard about. Because of the excellent academic and continuing education provided by the University of North Carolina School of Government, it's equally an opportunity to reach current and future leaders of this state and of our nation. Jess has heard this story before, but I don't know if you here at UNC recognize just how tough a place this is. In 2008, or in the fall of 2007, my oldest daughter, Elizabeth, was getting ready to graduate from high school in the spring of 2008, and we embarked on the traditional college tour. And the first place we stopped was UNC. We had lunch with Jess. She took the tour. She applied, and she got her letter, first one she got, putting her on the wait list. And I have to say, she was pretty devastated. She graduated in May, cum laude, from Harvard. You just don't know how hard it is to get in to North Carolina. Leadership. Leadership requires vision. And vision is developed through exposure to new ideas, varied viewpoints, to the fullest range of possibilities. That's the mission of our great institutions of higher learning like this one. But it's also the fundamental mission of the United States Navy and Marine Corps. Each service places incredible responsibility on our young officers and enlisted, and each service expects the highest standards of conduct and performance. And we've got a group of folks here, midshipmen, from the Naval ROTC unit, that will soon be taking up that responsibility. Because as part of its mission, UNC has had an NROTC program for years, as do some other local universities that are probably best left unnamed in this forum. More than many states, North Carolina has a special relationship with the Department of the Navy, particularly with the United States Marine Corps. But too many top universities do not have formal ties with our military, which is why one of the first initiatives I launched as Secretary was bringing back Naval ROTC to some of our great universities, including Harvard. Harvard had a long history of supporting the military, including the fact that behind only West Point and Annapolis, it had graduated the most Medal of Honor recipients in the country. But 40 years had passed since Naval ROTC had been on that campus before we reestablished it in 2010. Yale and Columbia followed very shortly thereafter. And the gap between men and women in uniform and those they serve to protect exists not only on university campuses, because today fewer than 1% of America wears the cloth of America, serves in our military. And too many of the other 99% have too little knowledge of who the American military is, of what it means, and of what it can do. This is especially true, I think, of the Navy and Marine Corps, because we are America's away team. When we are doing our job, we are usually a long way from home and out of the public eye. And I think it is an essential part of my job to make America aware of the incredible work of our sailors and Marines. They chose voluntarily to serve our country in the most extraordinary ways, always at great cost to their families and often at great risk to themselves. And I take every opportunity I can to thank them and to tout their accomplishments. Thank you, MIDS, for your willingness to serve. I just got back last night from an around-the-world trip. 8 days around the world, including two in Afghanistan. I have visited with sailors and Marines literally on 7 continents. I have lost track of how many all-hands calls I've done. But what I have not lost track of is the skill, the talent, the dedication, the willingness to serve that is embodied by every one of those sailors and Marines forward deployed, protecting America. Choosing to serve is what has brought most of you here today, too. You've already committed to doing something bigger than yourself, to contributing in a very direct way to the future of this state and of this nation. As Jesse said in my introduction, I have been very fortunate to spend a lot of my adult life in public service. As he mentioned, I was state auditor, an elected position in Mississippi, and then governor, then ambassador to Saudi Arabia, and now as Secretary of the Navy. I worked in business and helped a company come out of bankruptcy and save jobs. These professional experiences have afforded me a great deal of experience, I hope, in leadership. But my approach to leadership and public service, in reality, grew out of my time serving as a junior officer in the U.S. Navy over 40 years ago. Just gave you the schools that I went to, and I was privileged to attend some of the great schools of this country. And I received a first-rate academic education. But I received a very different kind of education in the Navy, where I gained life experience and learned that in the military, critical decisions are made every day that directly impact your shipmates. It's very different. Being up at 3 o'clock in the morning studying for the final that you neglected to study for previously in that semester, and being up at 3 a.m. having con on a warship going through the Straits of Messina. As a Lieutenant JG aboard the USS Little Rock, I was given a whole lot of responsibility right away. I became the mother, the father, the priest, the rabbi, the psychiatrist to a group of 60 people, most of whom were older than I was. It was the best education and the best experience I could have received as a 21-year-old young man. And it prepared me in so many ways for the leadership opportunities that followed it, right up to this job as Secretary of the Navy. In fact, I think it's fair to say that whatever success I have had in my life probably would not have occurred had I not served in the United States Navy. Each experience that I've had has taught me about effective leadership, and I hope it's taught me something about myself. Leadership takes a lot of work, as most things do. You have to do your homework so that you know what issues are really important, and you have to work hard so you don't disappoint the people who are helping you achieve your goals. You have to understand how to help your team achieve the goals that have been set and how to motivate people to do it. And particularly those of us who serve in public office, you have to have a pretty thick skin. I've had that particular attribute of mine tested in just about every job that I've ever had. But leadership, as I said at the beginning, requires some vision. Vision isn't just about conceiving of what could be. It also has to be informed by what has been. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. A second key lesson that I've learned is don't try to do too much. I was governor of Mississippi, the poorest state in the Union. And every day that I got up, there were about 1,000 things I could do that would make life better. But if I tried to do all 1,000, not a single one would have happened. And I'm going to digress here just for a second because I'm in North Carolina. If you want to know the difference that leadership makes, if you want to know the difference that one person can make, think of this. In 1960, North Carolina and Mississippi were almost identical states in terms of per capita income, in terms of population, in terms of manufacturing, any terms you want to pick. That year, you elected Terry Sanford as your governor. We elected Ross Barnett. Ross Barnett stood in the schoolhouse door at Ole Miss to keep someone from getting in. Terry Sanford opened those doors wider to have more people get in. And over the years, North Carolina, whether Democrat or Republican, have elected an almost unbroken string of good governors. Mississippi's record has been more spotty. North Carolina is now a top 10 state in everything that I just mentioned. Mississippi remains 50th in just about everything I've mentioned. That's the difference. That's the difference leadership makes. That's the difference one person can make. That's the difference public service can make. In any leadership position, you have to focus, because your opportunities are going to be limited, whether by time, by resources, or by the need to just get people with you. You have to focus on the issues that are the most important. You have to set priorities, and then you have to work hard not to get distracted from those priorities. And you've got to repeat it over and over and over again, and I have to tell you, people get sick of it. The press gets sick of it. Oh no, he's making a speech on education again. Your staff gets sick of it. The people that are for you get sick of it. But you have to do it. Because if you keep bouncing from issue to issue, you will accomplish very little. And finally, as Shakespeare wrote, there is a tide in the affairs of men which, taken at the flood, leads on to victory. When he was asked what he thought the meaning of that statement was, the noted philosopher and quarterback Snake Stabler replied, "Throw deep." And I think that may be the best advice I've ever heard for anyone in a position of real influence and authority. Throw deep. 237 years ago, our ancestors staked their lives, their fortunes, their sacred honor to the cause of freedom and independence. They threw deep. Bold steps are in our nature as Americans. Big dreams are what continue to make us a great nation. True greatness cannot be reached, and real change cannot be achieved by being timid. The theme of this larger conference, Leading in the New Normal, is a pretty appropriate context to talk about what it's been like to serve as a civilian leader of the Navy and Marine Corps over the last 3.5 years. The Department of the Navy is an incredibly big, varied, and far-flung organization. We have a budget of over $160 billion, 900,000 people. And even though we're a seagoing service, we own 3.3 million acres of land and have 72,500 buildings. On any given day, a third of our fleet is forward deployed in the oceans of the world. We are the world's only global Navy. As current and future leaders, you are no doubt very aware of the significant national security challenges we face as a nation, and as we come to the end of more than a decade of war, we also face some serious financial challenges. As a secretary, I'm responsible for recruiting, organizing, supplying, equipping, training, and mobilizing the Navy and Marine Corps. We operate today under pretty tough fiscal conditions, and under the requirements of the Budget Control Act passed by Congress last year, which requires us to cut $487 billion out of defense over the next 10 years, with a lot of the cuts coming early. At the same time, we also have to meet the challenges of the new defense strategy announced by the President in January. Now, this strategy, whether you see it as a rebalance toward the Western Pacific or an increased focus on the Arabian Gulf or on small footprint partnership building around the world, or as it was meant to be on all three, this new strategy is maritime centric. This new strategy requires a strong, a flexible, a great Navy and Marine Corps. Every 4 years after the presidential election, the Defense Department does something called the Quadrennial Defense Review, where we attempt to predict what conflicts, what obstacles, what challenges, what potential rivals we'll face for the next 5 years, 10 years, 30 years in order to get the armed services ready. And a lot of smart people work on that. It takes a whole year. But it doesn't matter how smart these folks are. It doesn't matter how insightful. The odds are they're going to be more wrong than right. Just think back 30 years ago, 1982. Who would have predicted then that the wall was going to come down before the end of that decade, or that the Soviet Union would break up by 1992? No one in the year 2000 would have predicted the events of 9/11 or the things that flowed from that. So really the requirement is, how do you prepare for the unknown? How do you meet the requirements of this new strategy? And all the while, get some savings from the overall budget. That's what I've operated under as Secretary. The Navy Marine Corps leadership, both civilian and uniforms, had to rethink what we do and how we do it. So I hope I took some of my own advice and tried to focus on what I would try to accomplish as Secretary. And what the Navy and Marine Corps do, and they uniquely do this, is they provide our Commander-in-Chief with the flexibility to do whatever mission needs to be done. That's whether it's high-end conventional combat, whether it's non-conventional, or in military terms, asymmetrical warfare, whether it's providing humanitarian assistance and disaster relief, or whether it's in building partnerships around the world. And by the way, it's not just around the world. Today, we have the USS Wasp, the USS Carter Hall, the USS San Antonio in New York, helping after Hurricane Sandy. In March of 11, the USS Ronald Reagan and her strike group were headed across the Pacific to do combat air support over Afghanistan when the tsunami hit Japan. The Reagan turned in a matter of hours and headed for Japan, and using exactly the same targeting techniques, using exactly the same equipment, the same aircraft, the same people, provided equipment and supplies and help after that devastating disaster. When they completed that mission, they turned again and went back and completed their other mission of combat air. I went to Japan just a couple of weeks after the tsunami and visited the Reagan. And in a room full of admirals and captains, I received my briefing on what had happened during the tsunami operations from a Lieutenant JG and a second class petty officer. Nowhere else in the world is that sort of responsibility pushed down to that level and those ages. Nowhere else in the world even hopes for the superior execution from those young junior officers and enlisted that we expect as a matter of course in the United States Navy and Marine Corps. So as we prepare to take on more responsibility under this new defense strategy, our nation will depend more and more on the men and women in uniform, on the men and women in the Navy and Marines. We call on them to deploy for an incredible variety of missions. In the final analysis, what makes the Navy and Marine Corps the greatest expeditionary fighting force the world has ever known is not the platforms, although those are important. It's not the technology, although that's crucial. It's the people. It's our sailors and Marines. And it's our job as leaders to maintain and to hone the effectiveness of that force, particularly given the high operational tempo of the last decade and the stress that that has put on our force. So taking care of sailors and Marines and their families has been my focus and my top priority as Secretary. So last spring, I released something we call the 21st Century Sailor and Marine. It's an initiative and a comprehensive effort to keeping our fleet ready to addressing current, future challenges facing the force and their families. We already had in place dozens of programs designed to improve opportunities and health care and well-being of our sailors and our Marines. But there wasn't enough attention paid to the fact that so many of these programs are interrelated. We had an understanding of the need, but the approach up until then had been just way too piecemeal. So we put it together under 21st Century Sailor and Marine because we want our service to be safer for sailors and their families. You should not be subject to sexual assault or domestic violence. You shouldn't be prone to suicide. And the factor that is common across everything I just mentioned, alcohol abuse. We have an obligation to those who serve us to make sure that they do not face life-altering or life-ending or career-altering or career-ending incidents while they are protecting us. We also want to encourage a real culture of fitness, one that reflects just how rigorous military life is and one that's not just aimed at passing the basic physical fitness requirements that you take every 6 months. We also want our military service to reflect our nation's core values of equal opportunity and equal justice. So among other diversity and inclusion efforts, we're moving toward ending barriers of where women can serve, including on my watch in submarines. And in order to better serve our nation, the military has to be reflective of the nation it represents and protects. It does us no good. It does not serve us well if any segment of our society is denied the honor of protecting this country. That's one reason we've been working so hard to put in ROTC at places like Harvard. And at the same time, the willingness and ability to serve our nation has nothing to do with who you love. And we've removed that barrier as well. When men and women leave the military, whether it's after 4 years or 40, we want to help them get ready for what is almost always a challenging transition. That's particularly true of our wounded warriors, people who have given so much for us. The Department of the Navy is helping veterans and wounded warriors find employment. And I want to thank Lou, who heads up the veterans employment efforts at Fidelity. for their work. We want to ultimately increase our veterans, and particularly our wounded, employability by ensuring that they have access to the education, the training, and the employment opportunities. But more than that, we're hiring people. We're hiring veterans and wounded warriors in the Department of the Navy. We have a goal and have had for the last 2 years of hiring at least one wounded warrior a day. And we've exceeded that goal both years. So that's one priority. The next priority I've had as secretary has been shipbuilding, which involves three things. First, we got to make sure our sailors and Marines have the best platforms to continue to have the most capable force in the world. Second, we've got an obligation to work with our industry partners to protect the skills and technological edge that they provide to us and ensure the jobs and the economic impact that they provide. And finally, just as importantly, we have a responsibility to taxpayers to be really good stewards of their money. Now, this is important to note. I am prohibited from engaging in political activity. And the things that I'm saying and I'm going to say about the Navy and Marine Corps are exactly what I've been saying for the last 3.5 years, usually in exactly the same language. As Jess alluded to, recently there's been a lot of discussion about the Navy fleet, and I'm not going to get into the political dialogue. But I can offer a few facts. On 9/11/2001, our Navy stood at 316 ships and had 377,000 sailors. By 2008, that number had dropped to 278 ships and we had lost 49,000 sailors. We simply weren't building enough ships to replace those we were retiring. In 2008, we only built 3 naval ships. In the last two years of my tenure as secretary, we have put 42 naval ships under contract. Most under fixed price, multi-year deals that assure value for taxpayers, certainty for industry, and strength for our nation. And this has been in the teeth of a tougher fiscal environment and the requirements of the 2011 Budget Control Act. As a result of that, our Navy is going to reach a fleet of 300 ships before the end of this decade. And those ships will be far more capable than the fleet of just a few years ago, and certainly more capable than the fleet I served in 4 decades ago. And finally, my third area of focus has involved energy. How we use it, how we get it, and how much we use. When I was getting ready for my confirmation hearings, I did a lot of homework. I sat in a windowless room for 8 hours or more a day and got briefings in 1-hour chunks from 8 in the morning till about 6 at night. There were briefings on everything from weapons to platforms to current operations. And one theme emerged over and over again. The kinds of energy we use and how much we use affects our ability as warfighters. The fragility and the volatility of the global energy market and the economic and security ramifications to the United States on over-reliance of foreign sources of fossil fuels are vulnerabilities that we absolutely must confront, and they are vulnerabilities that are only growing over time. I got to witness that up close, being ambassador to Saudi Arabia in the 90s. When you get a policy pronouncement by some hardliner somewhere, when you get national or transnational instability, when you get threats to close vital maritime choke points, when supplies of oil and gas are either potentially or actually disrupted, same thing always happens. The price of energy goes up dramatically with significant, dangerous impacts to our economy and our security. The U.S. military is the largest consumer of fossil fuels in the world. We spend, as a Department of Defense, your tax money, $84 billion a year keeping oil routes open. And for the Navy, every time the price of oil goes up a dollar a barrel, that translates into a $30 million fuel increase for us. So when Libya happened, and Libya is an oil producer, but in the big scheme of things, it's not huge, price of oil went up $40 a barrel, just like that. That's a billion-dollar bill for just the Navy. In fiscal year 12, that finished a month ago, the Navy spent more than $500 million, $500 million, in additional fuel costs because we just weren't good enough at forecasting what the price was going to do. And there are not many places you can go to get that extra money. The only places I can normally go to are operations, which means we maintain less, we steam less, we fly less, we train less. Or if the bill gets big enough, we buy fewer ships and aircraft. And I don't think we should make these choices. I don't think these are the only choices available to us. But I also knew that if you're going to address a significant military vulnerability and protect critical priorities like training and readiness and shipbuilding, we had to act big, had to throw deep. Nobody's ever gotten anything extraordinary done by being timid. So in 2009, I proposed some pretty ambitious energy goals for the Navy. And it was designed to make us better warfighters, to protect and improve our navies and our nation's energy security. The most important of these goals, which I am absolutely confident we're going to meet, is that by no later than 2020, at least half of all energy used by the Navy and Marine Corps, both afloat and ashore, will come from non-fossil fuel sources. 3 years later, we've made some pretty astounding progress toward meeting these five goals, and that one in particular. And maybe the biggest factor in the success thus far has been the way the Navy and Marine Corps, civilian and military alike, have embraced this culture of energy efficiency, energy change. Sailors and Marines, from Blue Angels to surface warfare operators to Marines fighting in Afghanistan, have embraced renewable energy, energy efficiency standards, and alternative fuels because they know firsthand these measures make them more effective, safer, better warfighters. Marines, in some of the heaviest fighting in Afghanistan, reduced their fossil fuel usage by up to 90%. SEAL teams, right now, are in the field with equipment designed to achieve net zero in terms of energy and water. They're going to make their own energy and their own water wherever they go. And we've also demonstrated that we can innovate when it comes to energy. We put a hybrid drive on the USS Macon Island, a big deck amphibious ship. It's got one drive for speeds under 12 knots and another, more conventional one, for speeds over 12 knots. It just got back from deployment. We had budgeted $33 million for fuel for the Macon Island for that deployment. They spent 18. And I visited Macon Island when they got back. And I visited the main propulsion officer. And he was proud of the fact that they had saved that money, but he was prouder of the fact that he would point out individual sailors, individual Marines, and say, this person came up with an idea of how we can save fuel on this. This person came up with an idea of how we can do this better. And he was talking about how the culture on that ship had changed. This past summer, we achieved another energy goal when we demonstrated the Great Green Fleet at Rim of the Pacific, RIMPAC, the biggest maritime exercise in the world. Among firsts that day were every single aircraft either catapulted off or making arrested landings, every single type of aircraft that took off from that nuclear-powered carrier, whether fighters or electronic attack or helicopters, did so on biofuels. The helicopter that carried me out there worked on biofuels. A destroyer refueled from an oiler, misnamed, on biofuels, and we did the first air-to-air refueling. And the most amazing thing about this was that nothing happened. We bought this biofuels, which part of them were algae, part of them were used cooking oil, in the open market. We put it in our supply chain. It got all the way off the coast of Hawaii, put into the engines on our ships and our aircraft, and nothing happened. We didn't change a single engine. We didn't change a single setting. And in fact, the only change that seems to have happened, the Air Force is doing a bigger study on this, is biofuel seems to burn a little cleaner. And so our engines don't gunk up quite as much. But same amount of power, same equipment, just a homegrown, less volatile in terms of price form of fuel. Now there's clear and compelling evidence that these energy efforts are important for national security. They'll save money and they'll save lives. But there's still some who question it, still don't understand why the Department of the Navy is doing this. This is where another key lesson about leadership was applied. You have to have vision for the way ahead, but that vision ought to be informed by history too. The Navy has always led in energy innovation. In the middle of the 19th century, we went from sail to coal. The early part of the 20th century, from coal to oil. We pioneered the safe use of nuclear for transportation in the middle of the 20th century. And every single time the Navy did that, every single time, there were folks who said, "You're wrong. You're trading one source of known and cheaper energy, in the case of wind, it's free, for one that costs more and is less certain." And every single time, they have been wrong. And I am absolutely confident they will be wrong again this time. And if price was the only thing we're looking at, we still wouldn't be using nuclear because our subs and our aircraft still cost more today, 60 years later, than they did. We also, by the way, would still be using typewriters because they're cheaper than computers. And rotary dial telephones, if you can still find one, cost less than a smartphone. But it's not just price. It's more capable. It gives us an edge. And as a civilian leader of this department, I'm committed to making sure that the Navy and Marine Corps continue to have that edge. I've talked about what I think effective leadership takes. I want to talk very briefly about how leadership can also inspire. You can imagine in the military, the ability to inspire can be the difference between success and failure, and it can be the difference between life and death. In our revolution, within the course of five days, George Washington faced two great turning points in the Revolutionary War. Christmas 1776, Washington crossed the Delaware, led his troops against the British and the Hessians at Princeton and Trenton, and achieved two surprise and historic victories that boosted American morale following a whole string of defeats ranging from New York down through Pennsylvania. But 5 days later, the day before New Year's, enlistments were up on New Year's Day for every single soldier Washington had. Having won two great victories, he was about to be left without an army. So the first thing he tried was he offered everybody a $10 bonus to stay, and not a single soldier accepted it, not one. So Washington addressed his troops. And what he said was, he acknowledged that too much had already been asked of them. But he said that their continued service and sacrifice was essential to assure the triumph of liberty and freedom. After this speech, every single person reenlisted. They might not keep fighting for money, but they would for a higher cause. Throw deep. And that's what the United States Navy and Marine Corps teach every single new member from day one. The unit is more important than the individual, and we have to uphold the values of each service through the fundamental concepts of honor, courage, commitment. It can mean winning battles and saving lives, but they're clearly relevant in every form of service. That's particularly true in public service that so many of you are in or going into, where you have to uphold a public trust. Honor is about being the same person in private that you are in public and being willing to be held accountable to that standard. When I told my dad that I was thinking of running for office, his only piece of advice to me was always be true to yourself and to what you believe. And courage isn't just the acts of heroism that we are fortunate enough to have from those who serve, although those acts are courageous and deserve our commendation and our respect. But courage can also be the willingness to keep going. Keep going in the face of adversity, the willingness after a failure to try again. And commitment in public service means a lot of things, but to me, it means having faith that your efforts will make a difference. Make a difference in people's lives, even though they may never know it. My father, who Jess was so kind to mention, and as he mentioned, ran a hardware store and grew trees in Ackerman, Mississippi. He died in 1986 at the age of 85. The last year of his life, he did not cut a single tree, but he planted thousands. And he knew for an absolute fact that he would never get any benefit from those trees. He'd never see a single dollar. He'd never get any reward. But he did it. He did it as an act of faith, an act of hope. He did it for me. He did it for his granddaughters he never met. He did it for their children. and their grandchildren, generations of my family, who I'll never know. And I think we ought to approach public service in exactly the same way. Uphold a public trust for the benefit of people we will never meet and of generations in the future we will never know. And they will never know what you did. Inspirational and effective leadership is a legacy all of its own. We just have to have the honor, the courage, and the commitment to believe we can change things for the better, even in the face of opposition. And I think that's my final leadership lesson. For any time you try to change something, no matter how vital, no matter how important, no matter how necessary, no matter how inevitable, there will always be people who oppose you, usually very, very strongly. And almost always, those opposing that sort of change find themselves on the wrong side of history. It's a tradition in the Navy and Marine Corps to end addresses with our Latin motto. So from the Navy, Semper Fortis, forever courageous. From the Marine Corps, Semper Fidelis, forever faithful. Thank you.